Listen, I think I want to be a theater actor someday. Why? Because I love reading books, and what is better than getting to live the life of a character? It's a life of lies. How? Oh, that it is not my life and I'm leading the life of a character in a fiction. Well, just because it isn't truth doesn't mean that it is a lie. You're reading too much Nietzsche these days. I mean, it's because I understand the characters and their emotions and I'm able to portray them, you know? What? About this video? Is this real? Is this truthful? I mean, it's in black and white, but truth can be subjective too. Is there no truth?
The 1950 film Rashomon, directed by Akira Kurosawa, is a classic tale of horde unit. Or so it feels like in the beginning. But as the story unfolds, you realize you have been lied to. Not once, not twice, but four times. Well, neither do we. The film begins with the false promise of a revelation. Four people provide accounts of a murder, all supposedly present, all for adamant that their version is the real one. Superior being that you are, you assume you will Sherlock Holmes your way out of this situation, but joke is on you. It has been close to 70 years, and the mystery of what really happened on that summer day in the forest is still unclear. It is not for the lack of testimonies, of course. In fact, it is precisely because of these testimonies that the truth is shadowy. Perhaps testimony is not even the correct term. A testimony is considered to be a truthful claim. The characters in Rashomon are making claims all right, but the truthfulness of these claims remain doubtful. The woodcutter initially swears he discovered the body of the samurai Takahiro in the forest, nothing else. But later dramatically changes his story. Apparently, he was the sole witness of the whole sorriness. The bandit Tajomaru, on the other hand, confesses to the murder of the samurai and the sexual assault on his wife, Masako. Masako, the only surviving victim of the ordeal, claims to have stabbed her husband. Or something akin to it. Very convenient and convincing that. If that doesn't make all this profoundly complicated and very hard to believe, wait until you meet the dead guy who testifies. That's right. Our samurai provides the viewer with yet another truth, a very helpful and melodramatic account of his murder-suicide via a medium. Sure. Whoever said only the dead can keep their secrets clearly underestimated the samurais of medieval Japan. It is in this contested reality that the crux of the film lies. The supposed testimonies of the characters are at best recollection and at worst reconstructions. The lack of credibility of the characters builds up as each story changes and modifications are added. For example, while his initial story about the discovery of the body in the woods sounds true enough and the least contaminated account, Kurosawa undercuts this assumption by making him recant his testimony towards the end of the film. This recanting also questions the credibility of the camera itself. Can we believe what we see?
ऐसी मत करो भाई।
Viewing does not happen in isolation. What we see is primed by the biases and prejudices we carry. Perhaps what the woodcutter claims to have witnessed, the wife provoking the bandit and husband to fight to death over her like real men, it could be an inherent need to view the world with a misogynistic lens that women are the instigators of evil and the reason for the downfall of any civilization. Whatever his motivations may be, it is clear that he is not the only one. The commoner is a realistic man, believing that all humans are inherently selfish and evil, and he uses this story to create his own worldview and to subsequently take away the clothes of the baby. The priest, on the other hand, is idealistic, believing man is a product of his or her circumstances. That is why the act of the woodcutter taking the baby away gives him a new faith in humanity by the end of the movie. Each character puts a spin to their tale, either consciously or subconsciously, to maintain notoriety or to appear sympathetic. If the people who lived these realities cannot concur on the truth of the moment, it is futile to assume that the viewer who is only hearing a copy of a copy of a copy can ever discover it. The subjectivity of these multiple realities makes it impossible to arrive at an objective truth. This film also led to the popularizing of the term Rashomon effect, related to the unreliability of truth as well as the visual representation of it. Sort of like the story of the five blind men and an elephant, where five blind men who have never come across an elephant try to touch one and perceive it. But each blind man touches a different part of the elephant's body. One touches the tail, the other touches the tusk, one other touches the trumpet. And they frame their perception of the elephant accordingly. Ultimately, everyone is right and subsequently wrong. This fable points to the human tendency to keep his or her own limited subjective experiences to be the only true version.
Interestingly, just like the characters, Kurosawa is also tailoring the narrative. He deviates from the original story, Akutagawa's In a Bamboo Grove, and mixes in elements from another short story of Akutagawa, after which film is titled Rashomon, to create a text that is unreliable in its adaptation as well as origin. His introduction of a second testimony through the woodcutter opens a whole can of worms, including the complicity of a seemingly innocent woodcutter, and further opens the doors for multiple endings and makes space for any kind of possibility. Mark Twain says, "Truth is stranger than fiction, but it is because fiction is obliged to stick to possibilities and truth isn't."